It's his birthday today, really? Huh. Yeah. I bet that's what he's wanting.
Matthew, we will meet after church.
All I'm asking is what's for lunch, and I'll meet you there.
Blame it on Cindy, and then you get away with it, right?
That's what happened.
Welcome. So good to see you, and I don't know what happened to my mask. It's in my office. See, I'm just falling apart this morning. So glad to see everyone here. I know that this week has been a good week, but disappointing in other respects. It's sad that we have to kind of take a step back. And I know there are some of you that are at home today because of that backward step. I assure you, if we didn't have to take it, we wouldn't have taken it. This is something where your safety is first and foremost. And so I want to state that. I really, really do. I want people to feel safe to come here and to worship and to praise God and leave here feeling like I'm safe, I'm good. Lots of hand sanitizer and a mask, that's going to get it done, I assure you. Let's just go through, by the way, we're going to be in the book of Ephesians. Those of you at home today, we will be in Ephesians for today's message. Thank you, Cindy. Just a few announcements before we get going. July Giving Tree for the July Project Giving Tree, one of the aspects that we're going for is still the Wesley House at Henderson State University there in Arkadelphia. We will be collecting from you until the end of this month, and then the church will be taking a check and coupling with your donations and sending that to them. I ask that you donate via our website. If you need to, you can drop off a check, but it makes it so much easier to go out and do that. Make a donation, hit that button on our website, and then donate. You can use just that one-time frequency in that little drop-down window. So please, let's help out that Wesley House there. We have supported them in the past, and I ask for us to do it again. This morning, as we pass the peace of Christ, I want you to feel it in your heart, because we all need blessings. I said it last week. When we pass the peace of Christ, it's just not a greeting. It is a greeting, but it's not just a greeting to greet each other into worship. It is a blessing. Let's stand. And if you feel comfortable going around and blessing each other and passing the peace of Christ, I ask you do so with either fist bumps or elbow bumps, if you feel comfortable enough. So let's pass the peace of Christ. Thank you.
that trumpet. Oh my God. And I will sing wherever I go. All right, here we go. All my life. Well, all my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. Last time, all my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. Yes, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. Thank you for coming to church this morning. Let's worship together. Let's sing about the name of Jesus. As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong.
Seated. Let me grab my pen. I'm going to start off with our prayer request time with the Hill family. Johnny Hill is doing about the same as last week. I was given a little update on him, and he's very, very weak. So please, that is my niece's father-in-law. And then John Hill had surgery this past week. Now, I want to describe John to you very quickly. John is a very quiet man. And he's about that broad in the shoulders, and that's where his shoulders are. He's a big man. But he had shoulder surgery. And to take a great big Texas cowboy and to knock him down and put his arm in a sling where he can't move it, he doesn't like it one bit. So please pray for him and pray for Carla as well, because she's caring for both for her husband and praying hard for her father-in-law as well as he's in the hospital. You see the other names there, Bob Pullen, Bev Drake, Brady, we continue to pray for you, brother. Johnny Hill, John Hill, Joanne Hansen. Do we have an update on Miss Joanne? And for Ryan Robertson as well, please continue to pray for him. Are there any others that we need to praise or add to this prayer list? Yes, ma'am. Yes, Joe. Wow. Happy anniversary, truly, as Bill sits quietly. This is... For those of you at home, Bill said, I know my place. Wonderful. Is there any other praises? Happy anniversary to you too. Welcome back the travelers to the north. And I believe we're getting ready to have them replaced by other travelers going north. Safe travels to you. Any other prayer requests? Yes, ma'am. Tom Noble, can you disclose COVID? Okay. And for those of you at home, that's Tom Noble. Tom has acquired the coronavirus, and pray for his wife who does not have it, but pray for her, please. And also add one more name to that, unless there's any others up here. And that is my granddaughter, Violet. They were sent home. Her class, I believe K-4, K-5, were all sent home on Wednesday, because there was contact tracing done. I don't know whether it was a child or a teacher came to school that tested positive. So please keep my granddaughter Violet. She has not shown any symptoms, and so we're just going to pray that she does not. Thank you for allowing that personal pastor preference, please. Yes, ma'am. Oh, my goodness. A great-granddaughter born of all places in... And Ivy, I figured they would name her Flame. Born in front of a firehouse. Wow. Congratulations to you. We will pray for Miss Ivy. And that's a story. Born in front of a firehouse. Any others? Yes, ma'am. Yes, Miss Kathy. Wonderful. That's praise. That is a praise. That behavior shows that maybe there's a turn on the inside that we can't see. Thank you. Thanks, Kathy. That is for Kathy's son, who finally acquired a job. Good. Any others work quickly? Let's go to God in prayer. Holy Father, you're so gracious, you're so loving, you're our Heavenly Father. Lord, you've changed us when you adopted us into your family. No parent who adopts a child leaves that child in the clothes that they used to wear. That new parent showers their new adoptive child with gifts and love like they never had before. Oh, Father, if we as human beings show that kind of love to an adoptive child, how much more love and grace and gifts do you pour out on your adoptive children? We are special. We are special indeed because we are now part of your family. We are truly brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, this morning, it's just so apparent. We are a little bit discouraged. Lord, we just don't like taking steps backward. But Lord, no matter what the enemy tries to throw at us, we will be overcomers in Christ. That we can do all things. We can overcome all things. We've been doing this for the last year, and we know what to do. Father, I pray for all of our brothers and sisters who are not able to be here this morning. Lord, please bless them. For our brothers and sisters in Christ in far-reaching places, even outside this city and outside this state, watch over them. Keep them safe. And Father, for the many people that are in the hospital right now because they have acquired this terrible virus, Lord, I just ask that you heal them. And Father, lastly, the healthcare workers, the doctors, the nurses, the patient care advocates, Lord, they have been doing this for so long. They're weary. They're tired. They are frustrated. Father, I ask that you give them an extra measure of grace. Give them an extra measure of peace. Lord, watch over them. They pour out their hearts every single day to care for those people who cannot care for themselves. Give them strength. Renew their strength, Lord. Watch over them and keep them safe. Lord, we pray. We pray constantly. As your word says, we pray in spirit because you, Father, are spirit. We pray in love because you, Father, are love. We ask for grace because, Father, you are grace. Father, in all of this, we ask, Lord, please hear our prayers. May you be edified this morning. May you be honored this morning. May you be pleased with everything that is said, everything that is done, everything that is sung, every word that is spoken. Father, be pleased and be honored and be present today. We pray all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Once again, we have placed baskets outside of our doors on the tables. If you have a gift, if you have a tithe or an offering that you'd like to give this morning, I ask that you place those in those baskets outside. We are not passing the attendance pads, nor are we passing our offering bags, so to speak. Let us go to God and thank Him for watching over us and for blessing us so much. Father, Our cups overflow because you do not let them go dry. Lord, our world, even though is in turmoil, wars and rumors of wars, Father, you reside inside of us. We have the secret of peace. We have the secret of joy. The most holy place inside of us. Father, let us call upon that joy. Let us call upon that peace. And Lord, as we give ourselves to you, we give back a portion of that which you have blessed us. Father, bless us not only monetarily, but Lord, bless us with wisdom that we are the best stewards of that which you bless us with, that we can bless others in kind. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
With grace and mercy, send.
right, just the voices with me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, we thank you so much for being who you are. Lord, the light you shine. Give the world a light to see. Lord, we thank you. Forgive us. Lord, we want to be in your light, just like you are in the light. Lord, I pray that you are with Doug as he brings the message this morning. And I pray that you touch somebody's heart. Ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Matthew. As you see on screen, the title of this morning's message is The Question Answered. I know some of you are pretty quick on the draw, and you're saying, he hadn't even asked us a question yet. Well, I did ask several questions last week, if you remember, and I gave a few answers. This morning, we're going to look at a church who had some of the same questions then that many churches do today, and maybe, just maybe, we'll get a few answers in the process. I know that's a quick intro, but let's turn quickly to God's Word. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. And I just pray that these words penned by the Apostle Paul ring true to us, that we truly hear the Holy Spirit speaking to us and not my voice, please. Ephesians chapter 3, beginning of verse 14. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all of the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. The word of God for the people of God. You know, I was thinking about last Sunday. If there was ever a term that we could apply to last week's message, it would be this: exhortation. Exhortation. Even though it might have been taken as a toe-stepping message, that is the farthest from its intent. I ask questions about expectations in our life, expectations in our worship, and I've even tried to get us to think about all of the power that we have through the Holy Spirit. In a nutshell, that is the intent of the Apostle Paul's message to the people in Ephesus, exhortation. If we were to examine this whole letter, we would not find a common phrase Paul usually uses, and that is, to the church in wherever. We would not find to the church in Ephesus anywhere. To the church in Ephesus. Now, in the first verse of this book, this letter, we find this phrase, to God's holy people in Ephesus, in the faithful in Jesus Christ. We find that phrase. Paul, in his letters, usually wrote to a particular church for a specific reason. This letter was not meant to address an issue or a problem, or in the case in the church in Corinth, address many problems. It was meant to encourage and to lift up the people in Ephesus and in that surrounding area. If a letter was meant to address a problem, we might think, and it was circulated to the outside churches, think about that for a moment. Basically, it would be airing the dirty laundry of that church. And the other churches would probably say, as some would today, well, I'm sure glad we don't have that problem over here at the Self-Righteous Holiness Gospel Church in Pascagoula, Mississippi. Yeah, that definitely is the log in your eye sermon, if there ever was one. Well, Paul writes this letter to the Ephesians while he is in captivity in Rome. Now, they had heard about his imprisonment and probably started to get discouraged a bit, or maybe a lot. They heard about his jailing. Now, if we look back just a few verses before our text this morning, we find this in verse 13. Paul tells them, I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are your glory. He's telling them, keep your chin up. It's going to be okay. There's a message for us in that one bit right there. We need to keep our chins up. We're going to be okay. Basically, if we were to take this whole letter and to look at it, Paul talks about two things. One is the unity in Christ. The other is the unity in the body. Today we're only going to scratch the surface of the unity in Christ, and maybe next week we might go into and scratch the surface of the unity in the body. Our text this morning begins with Paul using this phrase, for this reason. For this reason. That's kind of like using the word therefore. And you know, you got to wonder what that therefore is there for. You got to turn around and look backwards. This section that we have read this morning is kind of a wrap-up, so to speak, of Paul's point concerning the unity in Christ. He does it several times, uses this phrase all through the first part of his letter, but for these few verses, it's almost like Paul is giving a benediction, as we will see, because he prays several times for the people. You know, several times over the past couple of years, I've talked about how we have been made joint heirs with Jesus in all of the riches of heaven. This is exactly what Paul is doing with the mindset of being the unity in Christ. He's reminding them that they are part of the family of God. He says, for this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Every family derives its name. You know, when we meet new people, and we meet a lot of new people in the village, as I did Jennifer, right? Yeah. I met Jennifer this morning, and just mark your calendar, I remembered her name. Those of you that know me, names are gone. We want to know, we get to know them, we want to know, hey, where are you from? And that's one of the things that I asked Jennifer this morning. Now, I've been told that I don't have a pure Southern accent. But you put me in the country, and I'll get country on you. Or you put me in Baton Rouge, and I told you that, I be country. So when I tell people where I'm from, I tell them, well, I was born in Oklahoma. And then I tell them all the different places in the South and in the Midwest and in the West and the four countries that I have lived in. And that is where my accent is derived. It would be tough for me to do what some of the people, some of the cultures in the Middle East do, and that's add the city name to their name, their given name, to let people know where they're from, such as al-Baghdadi or al-Masra or al-Tikrit. Let people know where they were born. If our home is in heaven, which it is, and it's not here, then we could be telling people like this, hi, I'm Doug Walker, al-Heaven. It's our family name. That's where our new birth is from. You see, when we were adopted, I get adapted a lot. When we were adopted into the family of God, we took upon his name. Let that sink in. We took upon his family name. In all honesty, I don't know what God gave me as a family name. Nor do you. One day we're going to find out. We're all going to have that same last name. I'm sure that we will love it. Paul's first prayer that we saw in our text this morning is for the people to know, as a part of the family of God, that he has poured out riches from heaven upon us. He has shared, just like I prayed a second ago, when he adopted us, he gave us all of these gifts and shared in that wonderful bounty. Now, I'm not talking about gold or silver or precious jewels. I'm talking about the richness of the power we have through the Holy Spirit, as I talked about last week. The Holy Spirit who resides in us. In verse 16, we see, and you see on screen, I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. This, as Paul was telling the people in Ephesus and us, this is the first step in acknowledging our connection to God the Father through the Holy Spirit. A little difficult, but here's what I'm talking about, basically. We're going to put it down on Doug's level. Here's what I mean when I'm talking about richness. Remember, when God gave instructions for the construction of the Ark of the Covenant, remember? And we don't have the time to go back and look at it. I invite you to do so. It was made out of the finest wood. It had hammered gold all around it. And on the inside of it, the rings were gold. The lid was gold. It was beautiful. And even the figures on the lid were solid gold. This was the place God's Spirit resided, in the tabernacle, in the most holy place. It was beautiful, and it's opulent. as any place where God resides is beautiful and opulent and far greater, truly, than where we can imagine. When we're adopted, something changes inside of us. People say, well, my heart was changed. My heart was changed when I accepted Christ. Sometimes that's just passé, but it's not. It's not. It's really true. Just imagine for a moment God changing the inside of us. The inside of us to match the grandeur and the opulence of the Ark of the Covenant. Think about that. And not just that, but even a greater place, more than we could imagine. God is not going to adopt us and leave us unchanged. It's just that simple. He's not going to do it. He strengthens us with the richness of His presence, His power through the Holy Spirit to create a place where Christ can dwell in our hearts. Paul said it in the words this morning. That doesn't make you feel special. At least on the inside, nothing will. You know, when we think about our insides that God put in us, then we can boil it down to this. There are two kinds of people in this world. Those that have been changed on the inside, that's had the Holy of Holies placed on the inside of us, and those who haven't. It's just that simple. Either you've got Christ in you, or you don't. I don't care what city you're from, Al Greenwood, or Oklahoma City, or Minneapolis, I don't care. God is not ours. I said it last week. God is not ours. It doesn't belong to this city, this state, this church, this country, the whole world. God belongs to. When we were adopted, we were all made part of the same family, no matter where we live, in what country. That is unity in Christ, and that was what Paul was trying to get across. The second prayer Paul acknowledges is once that the people understand that, okay, I understand that we are all part of the family, the same family, there are a few things that go along with this adoption. He says, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people, together with all of our family, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled, to the measure of all the fullness of God. That's a pretty significant prayer that Paul prays for the people in Ephesus, basically for us. Paul tells them, once you fully understand Christ died for everyone, not just for the Jews, but for the Gentiles as well, and you know in your heart that He is the Messiah, God's Son, sent to us and for us, and have given Him your heart. Given, you give something out of your house to somebody else, it's no longer yours. You give your heart to Christ. God puts a new family heart inside of you, places that new heart, a heart suitable as a place where the Holy Spirit can reside, opulent, beautiful, beyond imagination. Then Paul says, we then know that we are joined together because of the love that Jesus has for us, as is evidence of his willing death on the cross. And when, you know, the whole world can say, yeah, I've heard of this Jesus, then when our head knowledge of Jesus turns to a heart knowledge of Christ, this is when God begins to pour his love into our hearts. Hold on to that thought, please. Because this is some pretty in-depth stuff. I'm telling you, Paul is, he writes way up there. I don't care if he lived a long time ago. He can write some pretty deep stuff. But you can really squeeze, when he writes, just like we're doing this morning, you can squeeze a lot of stuff out of it. But he's not finished there. He's not finished there. I ask you this. When you have a glass on the counter and you're pouring water in it, if you accidentally overfill it, where does the water go? It goes all over the counter. It goes down the front of the counter, onto the floor, and it just goes in every direction, doesn't it? And if the dog comes running through and steps on it, it just spreads it everywhere. We can't control it, can we? Unless we choose the quicker picker-upper. Bounty. Had to throw that one in. God's love is like this. If our hearts are so full of God's love that he has poured into us, do you think he's going to stop pouring halfway? Do you think so? Paul prays our hearts will be filled to the measure, so full some of it spills out. Where does this spillage go? Where's it go? The answer is in the final verse for today. You see it on screen. Now to him who is able to do immensely more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations forever and ever. Amen. Paul gives a benediction to his unity in Christ part of this letter. If we are in the family of God, then we have acknowledged that Jesus died for us, for our sins. We know God has changed our heart to a wonderful place, a palace fit only for God the Holy Spirit to reside. Then, as we begin to understand that God richly gives to his children, his adopted children, and he fills us up with all of the love and power, that some of it spills out. A bunch of it spills out. This spillage is meant for who? For non-family members. We bless each other when we get here. We bless each other during the week. But that spillage, oh yeah. We can love each other in Christ as brothers and sisters in the same family. As we open our heart to God and ask him to fill us up, he not only gives us enough for ourselves, he gives us some for others. We don't need to use our quicker picker-upper to gather it up real quick. Oh no. Leave Satan's bounty to over there. We want to make sure this goes everywhere. We need to be like that little kid on a rainy day, that little boy that goes out into the middle of a mud puddle and just jumps up and down and splashes everybody around. We need to do some jumping up and down during the week, don't we? We are one in Christ. We have that unity as part of the same family. We have the last heavenly name, the same name. God gives us so much love, more than we should be able to hold. We need to share it with others God wants to use us. Use us to bring more people into His family. Use us. The Creator of the universe using us. Wow. The answer to the question is not what you may have thought this morning. When we follow God's word and He pours out blessings upon us and fills us up, He wants us to use those blessings to bless others. I guarantee you, God will not let our cups go empty. God's not even going to let them go half full. He's just going to keep pouring like a never-ending spring that just keeps pouring and keeps pouring. This week, I implore you, please, let's share a little bit of that overflowing of God's love with someone who may need a little hope now that things are getting a little bleak again. People need hope. They need hope and they need God's love. I assure you, God provides enough to go around and around and around. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Would you please pray with me? Father, we stand before you. We kneel before you. We humble ourselves. We know that you are filling us up. Lord, I just, sometimes we just don't realize how much you do fill us up. But sometimes we also kind of take, we are so down, we may take our cup and we may say, Lord, let me just rest for a little bit. I need some rest. We know you're not going to stop filling, but you're also not going to stop ministering to us. When we need healing, when we need to be re-energized, Lord, that will be added to that cup. Lord, sometimes we get tired. Fill us, Lord. Fill us with your power. Fill us with your energy. Lord, give us grace. Cover us. Just soak us in your grace. Lord, may we be so filled this week that smiles are put on our faces and people wonder, how can you smile? Then let us give some of that overflowing to them. Father, we thank you. We thank you for being with us today. In Christ's name, amen. Would you please stand? We're going to sing a last song. As you see it in your bulletin, it is the song of commitment. As the tribes of Israel finished up their morning worship, they committed themselves. They committed themselves to God, and in everything they did the rest of the day, they did it as if they were doing it for Him. Just as the mother of Jesus, she went about her daily tasks as a young lady, as if she did every task for her Savior, for her Messiah. May we do this week in the same way as we sing this final song today. And if you need prayer, you come forward. Come forward and I will pray with you.
Lord, let your light of your face shine on us. Lord, let your light of your face shine on us. Darkest night.
God is ready to pour out his grace on each and every one of us. Just like the song says, we need to let him do that. We need to just get soaked this week in his grace. Just get sopping wet. Then let's do as a wet dog does, and let's just shake it off and get it all over the people around us. I know that's not a good visual, but guess what? It works. May you go here with smiles on your face. May you go from here with the confidence that you have had an experience with the living God through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And may you go in peace, knowing that you are a child of God. So I ask you, please, go in peace and be blessed. Amen.